I would like to present you Dr. Carla Sakotu, the president of Dystrophic Epidermolysis Bullosa Research Association, DEBRA Portugal. As you might remember, this is the association that will be supported by our participants' donations in the Registration Act. So now, please welcome Dr. Carla Sakotu, representing DEBRA.
Good afternoon to you all. It's wonderful to be here this afternoon with the audience in the late Saturday afternoon full of students in a symposium organized by students, so it's very exciting to be here. I would like to thank you to the organization, especially to Abel Nicolau and his team for inviting me to be here, for preparing such an exciting and scientific valuable symposium, and to integrate my presentation, which may seem a little out of topic, but we'll get there, to be present today. I also would like to thank you for contributing to DEBRA Portugal as the beneficiary association of this symposium. So I will not talk exactly about DEBRA Portugal. I will talk a little about epidermolysis bullosa, which is the disease that we support. And I will try to use the theme, the main theme of the Congress, which is solving tomorrow today, to see how can bioengineering and biomedical engineering can help these patients. So I'm going to start with a very brief disclosure. I'm the president of the board of DEBRA Portugal. I'm also a volunteer, but I also have other hats. I'm also a biomedical engineer from this faculty. I work across the road at the Faculty of Medicine. I'm an assistant professor there. I'm also the head of the Biomedical Simulation Center, and I'm research in one of our research units. Today, I'm here with my hat of president of the DEBRA Portugal. I need to warn you that I'm going to present some quite graphic images that might be sensitive for some audiences. So I'm going to introduce you what is epidermolysis bullosa. It's a quite rare disease, so you might never heard of it. I would be astonished if you have. So very briefly, it is quite rare. It's the incidence, it's one per 17,000. It's a genetic disorder, so it's hereditary. Anyone can have it. It's not gender or ethnic based, so anyone, both genders or ethnic groups, can have it. As it's genetic, it's not contagious, so you cannot catch EB. And unfortunately, up to date, there is no efficient cure. It's only palliative cares, as I will introduce you later. So this is a group of diseases that are genetically inherited, and it's mainly characterized by blistering or wounds in the skin and the mucosa. And the wounds and the blisters appears at slightly touch, just like a hug, or just by wearing clothes, or even spontaneously. So this is caused by the gene mutation that encodes specific skin proteins, and this makes the protein absent or diminished. And it can be transmitted in autosomal dominant or recessive, being the recessive transmission more aggressive and more life-threatening. There are three main types. There are three main types, but a number of subtypes associated to each of them. And there are a number of genes also associated to these, making these therapeutics quite a challenge, because there is no common therapy for all these subtypes. So today's challenge for these patients and the scientific committee is that actually only palliative care is available, and the care is limited to treating the wounds and bandage the patients. Patients have to wear bandages all the time to avoid infections and to provide comfort, and pain control. As you can imagine, having 80% of your body filled with wounds, and these wounds are similar to third-degree burns. It's quite painful condition that it's accompanying you all days of your life. This is a major burn for families, in a psychological aspect, but also a burden in the financial aspect, in the logistical aspect. These treatments take up to 3 to 4 hours every 2 days, so it's a major burn. And as it is a systemic, in most of the cases, or most aggressive cases, it's a systemic involvement. So the patient has not only the skin, but also the inner layers of the mucosa. This is quite difficult to have a systemic approach, but that's what is required. And the therapy must tailor to the different types of EB. As you've seen, there are different genes that mutate this protein, so these therapies need to be tailored to these specific genes. So, DEBRA International, which is the umbrella association that helps all the national DEBRAs, have set a number of priorities. And to set these priorities, there were a number of clinicians, researchers that were heard, but also patients and families that contributed with their experience to set these 4 priorities. And as you can see, developing therapies is one of the topics, but also the better understanding of the biology and genetics, and for instance, better management of the symptoms relief. Talking specifically about the development of therapies, there are 3 main approaches that we can envision that it will provide an effective treatment. There is the gene therapy, the protein therapy, and the cell therapy. And all of them have a local or a systemic approach. I'm going to give you 2 examples of the future that we see it today. This is using the technology that we have just heard, the CRISPR, to improve and to change this wrong gene, this mutation. So this is a quite recent paper, just published last year, in late last year. And using a patient's skin biopsy, it was changed, the gene was corrected, and then it was used again, a patient template, a skin template, and it was observed what happened to the skin. And the results were that different proteins, specific proteins related to the epidermolysis bullosa, were absent at the beginning, but then they were expressed in this corrected skin template. And here you can see the immunofluorescence staining. And as you can see, for these 3 proteins, the staining is quite bright. So the study shows that it's able to correct this mutation. Another therapeutics that is already in place is the allogeneic cellular therapy, in this specific case, the bone marrow transplant. This is the immunofluorescence stain of a patient, a baby, before transplant. And this was 2.5 years after the transplant. And here you can see a little red, which is the absent protein. And here you can see it quite well. And clinically, the changes are also impressive. So this is the end of the patient before transplant, and this is the skin after the transplant. So actually, we are using old technology, but also quite new technology to improve this disease and to find a cure. We are not there yet, but these new approaches need to be done, and we need to think out of the box, and this will facilitate the discovery of critical information and potentially a cure for EB. And these new approaches need to be validated, so it can only be validated if we invest on them, and this definitely will improve the life of the patients and not only their daily lives, but reduction of associated risks. And you can all play a role in this. You are future bioengineers, bioresearchers, biomedical engineers. So let's all make an effort and do something for this or any other disease. Thank you.